So now it's my pleasure to hand you over to Brenda Peterson, who will introduce our speaker. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm a member of the board, and it is my great pleasure tonight to introduce our speaker. I think he is the one person I know who best defines the term Renaissance man. He is a talented artist, illustrator, storyteller, teacher, and writer. And he is recognized as one of the most authoritative voices on heritage and planning issues in our city. Born and raised in Vancouver, he completed a degree in mathematics at UBC, and he started his career as a newspaper cartoonist. He now has over 15 books on his list of publications, and I'll list a few of those for you. Vancouver the Way It Was, Vanishing Vancouver, Paving Paradise, British Columbia in Watercolor, The Pulitzer Prize, The Pulitzer Prize, A Year on the Urban Farm, Canada, A Journey of Discovery, and Vancouver Remembered. He broke new ground in 2015 with his first graphic novel, Tashiko. His books have received many awards, including the Duthie Book Prize, the Vancouver Book Prize, shortlisted for the Toronto Book Prize, the Hallmark Society Victoria Award of Merit, and the Heritage Canada Medal of Achievement. His leadership and countless contributions to raising awareness about Vancouver history and our heritage are really too long to list, but I will mention a few key positions he has held over the last few decades. In 1991, he was the founding president of the Heritage Vancouver Society. He served as the president of the Langley Heritage Society from 1993 to 1998. In addition, he was our BC member of the Board of Governors of the Heritage Canada Foundation, which he served as chair from 1998 to 2000. He chaired the Vancouver Heritage Foundation in 2002 and 2003. And of course, he is well known to most of you here tonight as our current president of the Vancouver Historical Society. And I'm missing my last page of my notes, so I'm going to have to wing this. Going back to the theme of, thank you very much. It was at the membership committee. Returning to our Renaissance man theme, he is terrific at managing a budget, running a meeting, cultivating a vegetable garden, restoring old houses, and I hear Volkswagens, leading tours, navigating new technologies, and making a difference in everything he engages in. He possesses a great wit and prodigious memory, and he's a lot of fun at a party. And did I mention that he also bakes bread? What can't this man do? We are privileged to have him as our president and as our guest speaker tonight. I know that we are in for a treat as he takes us back on a tour of everyday life in the early 20th century Vancouver. Please join me in welcoming Michael Kluckner.
If I can possibly live up to that. Welcome everybody, and this is our first lecture of the new year, and glad to be here. Would have preferred to hear Maria Tippett, but that's the way it goes, because I know what I'm going to say. But our subject tonight comes out of just, you know, this kind of serendipity of a rapidly changing city. The Victoria Drive grocery here at Victoria Drive and William, so that's about halfway between First Avenue and Hastings. It had been operated for a handful of years as an art gallery called Dr. Vigari, and the name Dr. Vigari was an anagram of the surviving metal letters of Victoria Drive Grocery, and was done by Simon Kendall, who is a neighbor, and Simon Kendall was a keyboard player for Doug and the Slugs. So you get a little bit of an idea of what was going into that gallery, and the gallery still exists. It moved to Commercial Drive in, I guess, 2011. The building was bought. Everybody in the neighborhood was a bit on tenterhooks, not knowing exactly what was going to become of it. But they set out to fix it up a little bit. I should just go back, and you can perhaps see along the side wall there one of Eileen Mosca's whale murals from the 1980s. She was doing a lot of them around the time of Expo in that neighborhood. The stucco came off. Half a century worth of stucco, exposing the horizontal board siding, and then this rather faded old sign that was on the sidewall. And I saw this right away, and I thought, oh, Shelly's 4X Bakery. Well, I know a lot about that. Just so that I don't forget to say it, what does the 4X mean in this? Because it's going to keep coming up. And the best guess is that it means that it's a kind of a milling and sifting four times. There's a website, a grain grower's website, that says that it's because the bread was allowed to rise four times. And I think that would be some pretty tired yeast after four risings. But that name 4X is now, it's a type of video game. I think the X's are explode, explore, exhale. I don't know what it is, but anyway, there are 4X's in this particular type of video game. Back in the day, it was a brand of condoms, but it was also 4X being the mill, the actual mill that William Curtis Shelley owned. Now, Shelley himself, he born in Ontario, and he and his brother Frederick had been working as bakers in Ontario until they decided to move to Vancouver in 1910. I don't know anything about Frederick Shelley. He seems to have been very much the silent partner of the two. But you can see here, Shelley had a political career as well as a very, very successful business career. And we'll refer to that a little bit later on. I became aware of him back 27 years ago, I guess, when I was doing the paintings for Vanishing Vancouver for that book at that time. And at that time, there was a newspaper called the Real Estate Weekly that came around. And I would go through the Real Estate Weekly looking for the triggers that were for builders or for developers. And this was one of the houses that came up as being an opportunity for builders because it was on two lots. And so, you know, I dutifully roared over there and painted the picture for the book, and then went looking to see who the owner had been, and came up with this man, W.C. Shelley. And it opened just quite an extraordinary history about him, you know, particularly mentioning the politics of it, but then also how successful he had been as a baker. By the way, the house is still there. The house did not get demolished. Tenth and Ash, that's VGH precinct. This building is no longer there. This is a big industrial building for Vancouver at that period. You think of Vancouver as being sawmills, canneries, and then the handful of industries that seem to be producing consumer products, Rogers Sugar being one from very early on in Vancouver, and the Shelley's Bakery. This was the big one, but he also he developed ones in Nanaimo and then in New Westminster. as his business grew. It was very much that the sign on the roof of it was very much something that was on the skyline of Vancouver. This is a little piece out of one of the W.J. Moore panoramas from the 1920s, taken from down on False Creek, down around the foot of Heather Street, and looking up through the smoke of all of the sawmills up to the Forex sign standing up above the wooden houses of Fairview Slopes. This photograph a little bit later on, 1940, from City Hall, looking in a northwesterly direction. There's the plant there, and you can probably make out the scaffolding in there. And then as you look down, just Vancouver being a manufacturing town, primarily of 2x4s, the mills that are along the south side of False Creek at that point, and way off in the distance, you can see the really high superstructure of the Burrard Bridge that at that time would have been about 8 years old. So, you know, this was the Fairview area, the hospital grounds, that little park in the foreground there is for the normal school, the old normal school and the model school that were at the corner of Cambie and 12th Avenue. And Shelley himself, his really obviously was a terrific businessman, and this one out of the archives of his horse-drawn wagons, bread delivery wagons, and they were a big part of the image that he was presenting as a place where you would you could buy bread, that the bread would be well looked after and would arrive at your door or at your store very fresh. Another photograph, Dominion Photo Company from City of Vancouver Archives, is just about this entire presentation is from there, of a bread mixer in 1925. It's pretty large scale industrial kind of a process. And the employees that he had. So the company picnic of that period, very much in that style of the times of the companies like Woodward's, Roger Sugar, and so on, and everybody going over on the Union steamship's boat to Bowen Island for the day, and races and games, and probably a barbecue put on by the company. But it's worth just having a little spin through the legislation that was going on at that time to try to set the stage, what people were really thinking about at that period, and particularly involving women and their children, and that being something of the subject here. There was, in the years just leading up to the First World War, and then during the First World War, a very strong move to give women the vote, to give white British subject women the vote. And in a referendum late in 1916, there were two referenda that were approved. One was to give women the vote, and the other was for prohibition. They both passed. Prohibition only lasted till 1920, and women's suffrage has lasted to this day. It was enacted federally in 1918 so that the women are becoming empowered during this period. And there is also a recognition that is both a personal one expressed in that old saying that a man may work from sun to sun, but a woman's work is never done. And I think Nellie McClung used that slogan in campaigns for women's rights on the prairies. The Women's Pension Act, effectively kind of a baby bonus, but in a sense, and what made BC unusual about it was it wasn't restricted only to widows. It was for single women as well, for unmarried women, and that made it actually apparently one of the most progressive ones in North America at that time. Maternity leave legislation comes in, and then 1923, the Women's and Girls Protection Act. This Women's and Girls Protection Act speaks very clearly to the other major concern that was going on at that time, which was the sense that the Asian population, Asian immigration, was going to take over British Columbia. And so this act, as it was set up, it, in its initial draft form, it banned the employment of any white women, of any white woman, in any business that was owned or managed by an Asian person. And after protests from the Chinese consul and from the Japanese consul, it was toned down somewhat, but gave all of the authority to do that, handed it off to the chief of police of whatever municipality it was. But this came about partly just straight out racism. There's no question about that. Secondarily, the moral panic that was going on at that time about drug addiction in Vancouver. And drug addiction, drug addicted people coated with opium, which was said to be a problem almost exclusively of Chinese people or of Chinese Canadian people. And so the idea was that if you didn't have women employed, white women employed in an Asian-owned business, then they would be less likely to be exposed to the debauchery and corruption which inevitably flowed. You know where I'm going with this. There's other legislation going on. 1923, federally, the Chinese Immigration Act is passed, which stops all Chinese immigration into Canada all the way through until 1947. But there is still the what was called the gentleman's agreement between Canada and Japan that allowed a limited amount of Japanese immigration into Canada. And this was the era of the picture brides and the arrival of Japanese women to meet Japanese laborers who had already been here. Their marriage and then their production of children was a big concern of white people, of legislators and so on at that period. And the idea that white British Columbia was committing race suicide, this was a term that was used very much at that time. That was very much in the dialogue, and then also that women, mothers particularly, were the keepers of the race. They were the guardians of the white race. So this is all kind of playing along in there. You will see the term useful coming up in a couple of the ads. Useful coded for of sound mind, particularly in body, and so leading through to the Sexual Sterilization Act of 1933, which was ostensibly to rid the race of people who could not be useful. So this is this rather, really black undertone to that period. But the advertising, so where does the advertising fit in, and how explicitly does it seem to reflect these concerns? Well, the answer is it's really very subtle. Your look here, these are the earliest ads that I was able to find from Shelley. It's 1914, 1915, so we're in wartime there. And there's not a lot going on here, but you know, in terms of saying anything, the creamy crumb, you will see the white crumb and the creamy crumb. This is obviously a very, very milled processed bread, a kind of a white bread. And notice on the right-hand side, Shelley's was the original wrapped bread. So they are really distinguishing themselves from the more kind of folk bakeries and folk ovens that were selling bread around the city. Another ad from, this one's a little bit later, about 1918, 1919. Again, the idea of a well-run company, just one where you could be pleased to buy bread from. And again, just keep in mind, look how wordy these ads are compared with the ads now. People had time to read and wanted to read, and it was a much more verbal culture than today. It's a really badly proportioned man there, but for those of you at the back, a tip to hubby way down in your heart, why isn't your wife here? And I think it's worth reading the first paragraph of this. Man to man, would you, Would you, man to man, would you stop in afternoon after afternoon, baking over a hot range while wifey took in the beach and went swimming? You bet your boots you wouldn't. Then why not? Play the game 50-50. Take her along. And then say, well, you can take her along if you buy your bread from Shelley's. So we're getting the, you know, we're getting a real kind of a movement going on there. 1921, this theme begins, particularly in the summertime ads. And these are all advertisements that Shelley himself, actually not this one, but the other ones are all ads that Shelley himself clipped and pasted into a scrapbook that's now in the Vancouver Archives. Theme comes up again. And obviously, you know, I've talked about the background of the period of this idea of mothers being the guardians, the keepers of the white race and that. But there's obviously another theme in here too, which is that there's a genuine concern for women in the home being overworked. They have found by experience that there is more than 15 hours drudgery in every sack of flour. And today in these 50,000 British Columbia homes, mother uses Shelley's Forex bread. Well, this is really, you know, this is kind of setting it out. The loaves are entertaining in the drawing. So this is February 1923. Another one from that period, they really began to ramp up the issue of what women can do with their time. Shelley's Forex bread with its golden brown crust and tender white crumb is just a loaf of good bread. But you can see just all this wonderful coded image of the housewife who has time to do her needlework. And with the little daughter there learning from her mother. And all of this is what is necessary to raise a family properly, a part of which is to buy Shelley's bread at your grocer's or phone Fairmont 44. A couple of the ones here, the one on the left, by this time Shelley had become involved with the Gyro Club and opening up funding playgrounds in Vancouver. So that's really what's going on here. But you know, mother is able to take us to the park because she's not doing that 15 hours of drudgery with the sack of flour. The one on the right, I think, is probably the most interesting of all of them for a number of things that are going on here. It's delightful when toasted. We'll get back to toast in a minute. If you can see, if you're up near the front, you might be able to read it right down in the bottom below the rocking chair. The West demands equalized freight rates. Huh? You know, where does this come in? But this is Shelley beginning to get more involved politically, and that idea that British Columbia and the Prairie Provinces, to a lesser extent, were really disadvantaged by the freight rates set at Confederation, that advantaged manufacturing in Ontario and Quebec, and we were just the hewers of wood and the drawers of water. But I think in the body of the ad, it's you know, mother's important privilege. This is the mother's special role, and mother so quickly understands their childish needs. I wouldn't use childish in that term. I would say childlike. But anyhow, a child that is brought up in the right home atmosphere will grow up to be a useful man or woman. And this idea of usefulness, of people being contributors to society, was very much in the general dialogue at that time. The mothers are spending more hours with the kiddies, perhaps taking them to the sunny beach or the shady park, and all made possible by Shelley's bread. Another one, kind of a tip-in, a little tip-in sheet printed in two colors that would have gone into a cake, for example, that if you bought it at your grocer's. And there's another one of these tip sheets that are later on. There are many days, far too many, when mother is all tired out. Too much work and not enough play may not make mother dull, but it certainly makes her old before her time. and in many instances may lead to broken health. Our prescription for the summer of 1923 is make Bake Day a picnic and go on from there. This is a really nice one, a really contemporary looking 1920s woman with probably short cut hair. And a staged photo, whether this was done locally or not, I have no idea at all. But so you can see all of this going on here, a genuine concern for the overworked woman stuck at home raising children, hot oven, summertime, all the rest of it. And this one here then now is appealing, pitching it really to the husband. And one thing I'm not sure about in these ads, I know that the ones that are directly pitched to the housewives tended to be in the women's sections of the newspapers, which were expanding greatly in the 1920s. The literacy of women, the increasing number of middle class women, would be reading ads, and some of the ones that I've seen have been in there, but because Shelley had clipped these and pasted them into a scrapbook, I'm not sure whether an ad like this would have run more in the male part of the newspaper. That would be a really good question. But anyway, think how many hours your wife works a day. Yeah. These mothers are enjoying more leisure hours for the more pleasant things of life, thanks to Shelley's. Toast. You see toast in an ad and you think, okay, toaster, electricity, home appliances, these sorts of things. And this is the 1920s, and this is the first, you probably would say, the first real consumer decade of our history, effectively. And certainly in terms of the ability of people to have electric appliances. And 1920, the BC Electric Company, 1920 or 1921, the BC Electric Company bought the Stave Lake Power Company out in the Fraser Valley, and this gave them the ability to guarantee a lot of power in the houses, where previously, for probably the previous 30 years, going back to the late 1880s, when you had electricity in your home, the electricity would have just been for lights. And that idea of having any kind of electric appliance, but toast comes along. And so this is something, obviously, that people can go out and buy, and is something of a novelty. So the one on the left is just toast for breakfast, but the one on the right, and it's probably hard to read for people at the back, maybe your hubby doesn't like a big dinner at night. Serve some delicious hot buttered crisp toast with a cup or two of fragrant tea and eggs served his favorite way. And most any man will push his chair back from the table with a smile that won't come off all evening. So bet you that this one is in the women's section. So we're talking about electricity, and this is a time, and some of you may have followed the saga up on 29th Avenue at Granville of this model electric home that was bought by an investor who wanted to tear it down and build a bigger home in that. And the city stepped in about a month or a month and a half ago and put a kind of a 90-day demolition freeze on the building so that it could be evaluated for heritage purposes. And then I think probably to get the owner in and try to arm twist him into either selling the house to somebody sympathetic or else to working with the house. But the model electric home was a sensation in Vancouver in 1922. It's a very traditional home here, designed by Townley and Matheson, who are the architects of Vancouver City Hall. but it, so, you know, it's looking very much like that arts and crafts style of Shaughnessy, but inside, it was a thoroughly modern home, absolutely riddled with electric plugs, with appliances and all the rest, as a kind of a show home. And published around that time, actually a little bit before, was an 8-hour schedule for a housewife in a modern electric home, and it's quite interesting here, particularly the amount of leisure that is available there. not much in the morning, but it's 1:30 till 5 o'clock, recreation. But then, just as a cautionary note, in case people were getting lazy, two afternoons each week devoted to sewing. And then, prepare dinner, serve dinner, clear table, wash dishes, place cereal in fireless cooker. So all of these elements in here, the electric washing machine, iron clothes with electric ironer and electric gridiron, use a vacuum cleaner. Boy, what a revolution the vacuum cleaner was in the 1920s. And also electric refrigeration. But interestingly enough, that I remember seeing a statistic that, at least in terms of rental housing by 1940, that only half of the rental accommodation in Vancouver actually had electrical refrigeration. So the old Iceman cometh was still the case. Safety is another issue that just begins to come up on the scene. And again, it's very difficult reading it as you're looking for the codes of racism and of broader issues and so on and so forth. And it's pretty tough to see this, except in the second paragraph, if you can make it out, the itinerant peddler and certain classes of storekeepers will, if we are careless, undermine and eventually destroy the legitimate grocer's business. Well, the itinerant peddler coded for Jews. There's no question of that. And it was interesting, I was reading something that the Jewish Museum and Archives did in their publication. It was talking about Jewish people who had gone into the clothing business. And the one guy said that he had gotten into the clothing business because he had had a job delivering bread, uncovered bread, unwrapped bread in the East End, meaning Strathcona. And it was just the worst job because the bread was always getting wet. So he was, in a sense, the itinerant peddler going door to door. In that certain classes of storekeepers, well, you know, I think that they're speaking pretty much to the number of Chinese Canadians at that point and Japanese Canadians who were getting in, and because they were unable to be involved in any of the professions, it was not possible for them to work in some of the industries, that a store was actually a really excellent business for them, a live workspace. And everybody in the family could take turns. And that was something certainly the Japanese-Canadian operation of corner stores continued until 1942. And then but the Chinese-Canadian one, very much part of our language here of the idea of a Chinese grocery, had nothing to do with what was sold there. Health is another issue. And health and nutrition, and again with the idea of making your children useful, so that they would grow up to be productive and happy and healthy people. This is a really early one from 1915, but it begins to get going in the 1920s with much more, almost like a scientific way of looking at health. 1920s, scientific in terms of health, in terms of eugenics, all of this type of thing. But we are, we're saying here, you cannot serve too much Shelley's, for few people eat nearly as much bread as they should. But always remember, there are many grades of bread, and only the best will serve you best. So, and then a cheese toast recipe underneath. Nice little kind of handbill there on the left-hand side. You watch the graphic. The graphics here go to be slightly more stylized as we begin to work through the 1920s, and particularly I think this woman on the right-hand side who's packing hubby's lunchbox, going off there again, something of the modern woman emerging from underneath the Edwardian dresses and so on that are part of the earlier advertising. Your boy, it needs careful thought to decide what to put in the lunchbox of that growing boy of yours. Not sure what the girls were getting. Nice little graphic there, and note the character there, the little mascot guy, because he comes in and this is, you know, I think significant, at least in the development of the Shelley's advertising, of having a kind of a mascot. Cleanliness again, this is going back to 1919. They don't need, you know, I'm looking through this and not with any conspiracy theory particularly in mind, but I'm looking for the kind of ads that you would have seen a decade before this in the sugar wars between Rogers Sugar Refinery and Rithets, where they were putting up white labor only or so on right in the advertising, and you don't get any of that. It's much more subtle, really. That idea of the cleanliness and so on, but you get that coming through in the advertising illustration too, that this is people just like you are making your bread. So here's our little guy, and I apologize for the blurriness of the image here, but he becomes a mascot for a couple of years in the 1920s. Almost a street urchin with his cloth cap, almost child labor, you would say, but he's something of a mascot. And you can read that there, I'm sure, spotlessly clean, my boss demands each Forex wagon and salesman's hand. So, you know, again, distinguishing themselves very clearly from the people who would have unwrapped bread on a counter, flies, all of that type of thing going on. Another ad from, I think this one's 1925, my only job is delivering bread, others put the horse to bed. So, you know, a well-managed kind of a system. And this would be probably, I'm guessing, would be running in the women's section of the newspapers. If I had another lifetime, I would go back and go through all of the newspapers and try to find where these were. But everything begins to change for Shelley's, at least in terms of newspaper advertising for a while in 1926, as Shelley's political career begins to take off. And he does a very interesting series of ads on historical British Columbia and engages a new advertising agency, A.J. Massey. I know nothing about them. Somebody out there, there's probably a master's thesis in this for you, studying the early advertising agencies of the time. But this example of a series of ads that you would clip and keep becomes very much a part of advertising in that period and then going right through, and similarly follows through with collecting baseball cards, collecting hockey cards, all of the things of that period. So this one here, you know, watch the papers carefully for the new Shelley series, The Romance of British Columbia, and the wheaty flavor. Two more that Shelley clipped, number four, number five. You know, they're interesting for the, you know, I guess the sympathy that they show for what he is effectively describing here as a vanished race. Chief down on the type on the left hand side, Chief McQuinna's welcome to Cook, the courier of civilization, is reflected today in the welcome accorded to Shelley's modern bakery service. Anyway, that's, you know. And there's a horrible little story in there that I won't read out, a kind of a patronizing story about Aboriginal people meeting the couriers of civilization for the first time. But nevertheless, this is interesting. This is the 1920s. This is when the native presence, the Aboriginal presence in Vancouver, is now being recreated as a tourist attraction in Stanley Park, with the first totem pole display. And Shelley, of course, is on the park board, and he's very, very interested in this, partly for business, but partly probably from a genuine interest in the past. Maybe this is a bit of a hint of why the ads that were in the white press, in the mainstream press, didn't have any of the kind of overtly racist things that you see in other places. Chinese newspaper ad from the mid-1920s. On the left, a Japanese newspaper ad. Someone is going to come up to me one of these days and say, I'll translate these for you. And it would be very interesting to see what they have to say. And just some of the other things that Shelly clipped and he put into the scrapbook. This is a bread wrapper, so the famous Shelly's wrap bread, you know, beautifully printed, and designed little covering for the bread, and all of these little tip-in cards, so that when you bought one product from Shelly, you got a different tip-in card there. So he's really working, really in a very sophisticated way, working to expand his business. So the evolution of the advertising character. This is where I get really more into conjecture, because I haven't been able to tie down exactly what happened in newspaper advertising after Shelley quit clipping for his book. Just the volume of material to go through has escaped the amount of time that I have. This character here, stylized, very simple. Of course, this is painted as an advertising hoarding on the side of a building. But in 1939, it's evolved a little bit further. And when I saw the photographs of this in the archives for the 1939 campaign, I was struck by how similar it seemed to be to the Monopoly character. And Monopoly is 1934, 35, somewhere in that vicinity. But that kind of jolly figure going along there. And certainly by 1939, this, I would say, is a later character than the one that is painted on the sidewall that we still have. Shelley's put up streetcar ads, buttermilk loaf and so on, a couple of, you know, kind of an evolution of the character to a degree. But was still doing poster advertising, billboard advertising at that time in a quite realistic, almost a Norman Rockwell style. And probably partly this is just because these would be multi-panel silk screens. And they had the ability by the early years of the 20th century to do really quite sophisticated color blending on silk screens. And so, you know, you're getting something that is looking really beginning to look like Norman Rockwell, looking like magazine illustration in the United States in the 19-teens, 20s, and 1930s. One other one there. This is from his scrapbook. And then the final one that I was able to find from that period, from 1945, a much more stylized character, a much simpler slogan than, of course, this is a billboard. But the type is a complete evolution away from that more formal type that you had in the 1920s advertising. So around 1950, when Shelley died in 1951, the Shelley's brand disappears. And we'll talk about how that happened. But talk a little bit about Shelley himself. He obviously, by the size, the scale of his business, he became very successful. A photograph here of him and his new McLaughlin Buick. Not sure where that is. I can't, I'm thinking the West End. I just can't figure out a building like that ought to ring a bell for somebody in that time. He bought a downtown building. It's still very much there. It's part of the DERA assisted housing buildings. This is just near Victory Square, 119 West Pender. But a very handsome building as an investment. And publications that he clipped, business publications, extolled the quality of the business that he had built. He really is thinking big, and in 1925 he founds Canadian Bakeries Limited, and has a capitalization of over $1 million, which is an enormous amount for that time, and he sells Shelley's Forex to Canadian Bakeries. So he's beginning to exit. He's very active in Conservative Party circles in Vancouver, and he's beginning to think provincially, as well as getting out and getting into other businesses. His biggest, well, I guess probably his legacy, in a way, was the development of the first resort on Grouse Mountain, 1925, 1926. And this ad is an offer to invest in Grouse Mountain Highway and Scenic Resort Limited. He had to create the highway, which is now Mountain Highway, and created it as a toll road. And by 1926, you could drive quite, you didn't have to put your car on the ferry to go across. You could drive across the rickety little road rail bridge that crossed at the Second Narrows. Again, that was a toll bridge as well. The proposed Grouse Mountain Chalet, at least according to the newspaper ads, you practically expect to see Eva Braun waving out of the top windows there. But in the event, it didn't look at all like the Austrian Alps or the Swiss Alps. It looked like this. This was the building that was the Grouse Mountain Chalet from 1926 until it burnt down, I believe, in 1962. Swedish carpenters imported, designed by Townley and Matheson, the architects of Vancouver City Hall, all built out of yellow cedar. Just a really stunning building. And I don't often wish that I was older, but I wish that I was old enough to have seen this and to have remembered this. This interior shot from there. It's really quite a lovely place. One thing that I didn't mention about Shelley was that during his time in the park board, it coincided with what were called the squatter trials in Stanley Park in 1925. A group of First Nations people and mixed race people who had been living in the park for years. Had been given eviction notices repeatedly by the park board and fought back and said that they were squatters. And there was one woman, a woman by the name generally known as Aunt Sally, who was able to prove her continuous occupation of her place in Stanley Park for 60 years. And so she was given an acre of fee simple land in the middle of, not in the middle of Stanley Park, but out by Brockton Point. If I can just read a little bit here. Where are we here? Her case proven, that's Aunt Sally, received a number of offers to purchase her land, all of which she refused. But late in 1925, Shelley heard that she was about to accept an offer from a private firm that was hoping to erect an apartment building there. Shelley approached City Council for $18,000, the asking price for the acre, but was turned down. So he and his lawyer, Leon Ladner, did I say that right? He and his lawyer, Leon Ladner, went to the park to negotiate with Aunt Sally. In short order, they had struck a deal by which Shelley bought it himself for $17,500 of his own money. City Council eventually reimbursed him, but refused to pay him interest. So an interesting thing, and so how much was $17,500 in the 1920s? That would have bought you four very good quality Kitsilano houses, I would say, at that time. So a significant amount of money, and the asking price. So Shelley has this on his CV, too, of managing to keep that part of Stanley Park free of commercial development. His other business activities, he gets very involved and becomes the president of the Home Oil Company. This is one of the biggest suppliers of fuel oil and gasoline into British Columbia at that time. Production in Alberta in the Turner Valley and by rail car and truck getting that oil here. There was a big home oil kind of a tank farm just on the other side of Burrard Bridge in the 1930s. Ads that he clipped from that period. And a banquet that he hosted at the Hotel Vancouver. I put this in just particularly because I love the first item on the menu, given our current concern about tankers in the harbor. So a grand banquet at the Hotel Vancouver in 1928. And his wealth, he had a yacht built at Hoffer's on Coal Harbor, the Cora Marie, named after his wife, and launched in 1930, just as the world was sinking into the Great Depression. In 1928, he ran provincially and was successfully elected as part of the businessman's government, as it was dubbed, the Tolmie government, conservative government, and he became the minister of finance in that government. Which, much as Herbert Hoover did in the United States, he was confronted with the Depression and was just completely incapable. That government was completely incapable of dealing with it. They ran their mandate out in 1933, and if memory serves me, I don't think a single conservative was elected in the 1933 election. It tipped over then into the Liberal government of T.D. Patella. His house that he moved to in the late 19-teens on Matthews in Shaughnessy, this is now the American Consul's residence. If you hang out with the right people, you might get invited there to a reception at one point or another. And I'll just actually, with that one, I'll finish off with kind of a wrap-up on Shelley. After the demise of his political career, he faded very rapidly from the public scene, lost a lot of money on his investments during the Depression. And by 1938 to 1940, he was completely retired, except he had a hobby as being a magician. And he was a very, very good amateur magician. Newspaper article, 1941. Mr. Shelley is the only member of a large family who is a magic addict, and he explains this by saying, "One nut is enough." We first went on a tour of the sections of the Shelley home devoted to magic. In the basement, there is an amazing workshop where Mr. Shelley personally manufactures the implements of his hobby. And in another section, he keeps the rabbits and goldfish who act as his stooges. Upstairs, we went into a small room, lavishly painted in yellow, gold, and Chinese red, colors dearly beloved by every magician. And here are stored hundreds of gadgets, including a small mahogany box. This was put together by Mr. Shelley in the trick, which consists of placing a playing card in it, closing the lid, and then opening it to reveal no playing card, has consistently fooled every visiting wizard. So, and then another article a couple of years later. He's acting as a magician. This is 1943 for about 300 children from Gordon Neighborhood House. This is in the middle of the Second World War. Bill pulled rabbits out of hats and made things come out of everywhere for a solid hour. Then it happened. He put a big empty dish on the table and he waved a big magic silk shawl over it. And then there it was, candy, piled in the dish until it spilled over onto the table. And you can imagine the unveiling causing a sensation because there had been sugar rationing for a year and a half by that time. So, you know, really interesting man. All of the complexities of conservatives of that period, of businessmen at that period, but a really interesting character. He had one son that went on to become a documentary filmmaker, and the others I don't really know anything about. But we'll just go back to the sign briefly and wrap up with this of how you get a sign going. What happens, let's say this, what happens to a sign painted about 1930, covered up with stucco probably about 1950, and then exposed to the bright south sunlight in 2011? You can see how deteriorated, how rapidly it deteriorated when the sun got at it. And it probably wasn't in very good shape even in 1950 when it was covered up. So large parts of the sign had effectively disappeared, but you know, you could make out the design of it. And so a group of us who live over in the neighborhood raised money primarily from the owners via Tevere, the owners of the new restaurant called Via Tevere that occupied the place, and raised some money to pay ourselves and also to hire a mural expert, Victoria Ojinski, who was the one with the real expertise of working on walls and stabilizing paint and stabilizing surfaces and so on. And so in the spring of 2013, we worked away on this thing, redrawing the missing parts underneath, knocking off loose pieces, stabilizing the clean surface of the wall there, and then repainting, retouching the sign, just as I say here, adding just enough color. We didn't want it to look new. We didn't want to repaint it. And you know, evidently, when somebody is drawing a smiling face, they're smiling too. I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't seen the picture. But it came all together, and the only thing that, to my eye, makes it look not as antique as I would like it to look is the UV coating on it, the ultraviolet light coating on it, and which doubles as an anti-graffiti coating. So it's really hard, and it's a little bit glossy, and it seems to have dulled a little bit over the years. The coating has, anyway. So it's not quite as bright as it was when we did it. But there it is. It's the last advertising sign painted on wood in the city of Vancouver. A huge thanks to Via Tevere for, first off, keeping it, for not stuccoing over it, and then for helping us to restore it. And as for Shelley himself, is he commemorated in the city of Vancouver other than with this sign? Yes, by a small park, but they misspelled his name on it. The interesting thing is we discovered the misspelling of it, and it was misspelled in the sign. And they've changed the sign now. The sign is spelled properly, but they don't seem to be able to change the website yet. So I would have thought it would have gone the other way around. We were waiting for years on that. And I'm not even sure if you look at that Shelley sign that they didn't just peel off the E and skid the Y over, but however they did it, it works. So... Yeah. Yeah, maybe so. That would be the thing. Yeah. But anyway, that's the story of the sign and the story of Shelley's, and I think a little bit of insight into the way people lived at that time and the concerns, particularly from mothers and their little children. And I hope you enjoyed it, and thank you all for coming.
So thank you very much, Michael, and I would hope you'll take a few questions.
Anybody? Yes?
What became of the bakery, the big building near the hospital? Do you know who bought it eventually?
It was there for years, but just an anonymous something. I don't know. I don't know what it was used for. Anybody can help me out on that? And it's gone now. It's demolished. But I think quite recently it was demolished. Looking. Yes?
I noticed on the very first slide that you had, is it possible to go back to that? You were talking about the origins of the 4X.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed on that very first slide, they're describing what happened on the different floors in the factory. And I just wonder whether that had anything to do with it.
Go back to the very first picture of the factory. Da 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 da. The flower starts in the top floor where it passes through. Yeah, well, that would be something that would be worth digging out.
And it might have something to do with what the floor is. It has to go down each floor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, The main research that I did on this was back in the 80s, and I do recall a reference to this milling and sifting to get a very, very fine flour that would give a light bread. That's what sticks in my mind about it. Anybody else? Yes?
In terms of that building, I seem to remember that building's next to where the new cancer research building is. And there was a time and that lot is now vacant, and there was some talk about building another cancer research facility there, which I guess hasn't happened yet.
Huh?
But there was a time when that building had signatures on the side of it that were put on by donors. I don't know if anybody remembers that. I remember walking by it, and there was all these names graffitied on the side of it. So I have a feeling it was used by the hospital.
Yeah.
And perhaps even the cancer agency.
Yeah, could be. Yeah. Yes?
Is there a lot of his friends somewhere in existence?
and if so, you're volunteering to eat it? I don't think so. I don't think we ought to be on the museum tour tonight if there is one. Yeah, it's fine.
It seems to me that new building, that the owner of that building, his private quarters upstairs. Now, nowadays, when you see new buildings, where the stores have a second story above the store, like there's some new developments on West Boulevard now. But I don't think the proprietor has his private quarters upstairs. I think they're rented to someone differently, that a modern tenant.
Yes, yeah, that's true. And that grocery, Victoria Drive grocery, possible that the proprietor lived upstairs, but there were two apartments up there. But that idea of the corner store as a self-contained unit, absolutely brilliant piece of design for that period, the kind of live workspace and adaptation of a really simple house form in most cases. This one, I think I said 1922 building, so it's wood frame with obviously the wood siding over it, and then it was stuccoed and is stuccoed today.
Perhaps you remember how there used to be a store called Briscoe's on the southeast corner on 45th and Vine, and they had a little guard. Do you remember that building?
And many others like it. And actually, along Victoria Drive, Victoria Drive is, I think they're trying to call it a neighborhood collector, which is a lower form of roadway than an arterial. But it's dotted with these little commercial buildings that are non-conforming uses under the current zoning. But the city is trying to encourage these buildings to continue to exist. And one of the first ones to come up was Via Tevere, and became Via Tevere. And then there's another one a few blocks down, the Scott's Grocery, that is now running as an antique store. And another one a few blocks south that is, I think, Spice Islands. It's a specialty spice place. But, you know, they give that little bit of animation to what's otherwise a completely residential neighborhood. Yeah.
The interesting thing is that the new official community plan for Grandview has all the previous retail outlets marked with a little red star, some of which are now homes that people are living in.
Yes.
So they've kept it alive, and this one on Semlin Street,
yes,
which is now a home.
Yes. Yeah, and the little mid-block ones that are in neighborhoods, when you can find them. This is part of the Marché Saint-George, on St. George Street in Mount Pleasant, is one that's been very much in the news because the city wanting to shut it down because it didn't meet the zoning, and the neighbors wanting it to continue operating because it, you know, became a magnet for that. And, you know, there was that lovely ad of the little girl, I think, going to the friendly proprietor, and, you know, being sent to the store by her mother. Very much a nostalgic kind of an image from an earlier era. I mean, often it was, I need some cigarettes. There's money on the table. You know, and you'd go down and get cigarettes for your mother or something. Yeah. Anyway, anybody else? Yes. Sliced bread. I don't know.
Machines only came in the 20s.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think I've seen any references to sliced bread, and there weren't any in the ads.
No.
Yeah. And that's a good question. How about that?
Well, on behalf of the Vancouver Historical Society and for everyone here this evening, Michael, thank you so much. And I think we're all going to keep an eye out as any stucco is removed from any nearby buildings. We'll watch for some more signs to show up. But thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.